Did y'all make it out of spring break season okay? Welcome back to season 2 of the podcast. Different name, same concept. I've got things to say about everything. This season, we're doubling down on the mental health content, continuing to ponder the randomness of life, and trying to keep some laughs sprinkled in between. You can keep up with me on Instagram and Threads at Pat Pontificates and subscribe to the weekly newsletter at patpontificates.com. All links are provided in the show notes. I'm your host, Patrice, preaching authenticity, wellness, and freedom to the masses. Let's disrupt. First of all, I'm not even clear on what it means to be a girl's girl anymore. Because I always got to make disclaimers on here. What some of you seem to be describing sounds like enabling. I have absolutely no interest in that. And the plot on being a quote unquote girl's girl has been diluted so bad it is literally running like a stream of water away from some of y'all. So I just want to say, I consider myself a girl's girl, but perhaps I won't even do that. Just know I'm for the girls, theoretically. However, the girls have work to do. So let me be clearer on why you can keep me out of the girls' trip group chat and why I think we need to defund it until we restructure it. What is it? Reform it? Abolish it. Whatever we have to do, it requires something new. So, something that I'm really trying to release I have been releasing myself from the burden of is the emotional labor that happens in platonic relationships with friends that is really just a byproduct of the emotional labor that people are choosing to do in romantic relationships, which leaves them with nothing for you. I hope you followed me. I will repeat. I am removing myself from electing to do or being dragged into, but either way, I have a choice, emotional labor that is left over from what the person that I am in friendship with is requiring me to do because they have no spoons, no space, no emotional labor left for me. Well, no space. Let me not say emotional labor. They have nothing for me because they have, or themselves, because they have depleted themselves so much running after a partner. Most often, we're talking about a man. Okay, this is almost exclusive to heteronormative relationships. Heteronormative does not just mean heterosexual in this context, because a lot of the gays are doing what the straights do, and we know why that is, because heteronormativity is just extremely pervasive. That context established, anybody who knows me relatively well knows that I am systemsed down. I'm sending out spreadsheets for first of all, I have friends. If you don't know about my spreadsheets, I spreadsheet everything. I really know it's because I like straight lines and I see and can envision things better if they are in straight lines. You can make assumptions about what my diagnosis is from that. However, I'm sending out spreadsheets for the getaway. Right? And they add and subtract things for you. That's a really nice thing. There's a spreadsheet for hotel comparisons with costs before we even decide where we're going. There's a spreadsheet in that hotel spreadsheet. There's available amenities, distance to primary points of interest, distance from the hotel. From the airport. Is there an airport shuttle? All of those things. There's another tab on the spreadsheet with itineraries. All that. What kills me are the girls who think you're going to be asked Jeeves throughout the entirety of the experience from inception onward. Like, y'all do realize there are people who are compensated for that level of concierge. Worst, you also want me to plan a trip that takes into account what everybody on the trip wants to do, which wouldn't be the worst thing in the world if not for the fact that nobody knows how to make a decision to save their lives. No one's researched anything about where we're going. So somebody is looking for, you know, I don't know, a Jamaican restaurant in the hotel district in Cancun. They don't have those. They just don't. And then when you get there, you're back to being concierge, because you're not just the travel agent. You're the event host. You're the designated everything. And as God is my witness, I will never do that again. Now, before I continue listing all my pet peeves, you may be wondering, now, what did that have to do with emotional labor and partners and all those things? Because you know how it's popular to talk about weaponized incompetence, especially as it applies to men. And the wives are sending their husbands to the store with pictures of everyday household items so that they can come back in the home with the correct things. Okay. Arts and crafts project just to send them to the store. At that point, go yourself. But that's what they want, right? And women who literally babysit their children's fathers in order for them to watch their own children. That whole spiel. Or women who walk their partners through emotions and emotional expression and communication and all those things. Just all the hand-holding that they do for somebody else. Suddenly, they don't know how to do it when it comes time to plan a group trip. All of a sudden, now they're the baby. Whether this person at the time is single or not, it's something that I've seen you do for Hakeem. I've seen you do it. And now I'm asking you to click on a link and open a spreadsheet. And suddenly you don't know how to access the Microsoft suite. Focusing so heavily on relationships, being ready for them and positioning yourself for them and doing all these things to catch a person, catch a man, catch a whoever, catch a whatever, has led to this systemic deprioritization of friendships that we are now feeling the effects of, as we've realized that some people very seriously want to play in your face on purpose. Some people very seriously just don't want to be with you, and there's no amount of good girl that you can put on. There's no amount of provider you can be to make somebody or control somebody or manipulate someone or audition for a friggin' partner. Now we're like, dang, but I'm lonely. Or like, I don't want to date no one, but I'm lonely. I don't have no friends. Varying reasons, but deprioritizing friendships is part of that problem. What does God to do with the girls trip? Because the way that y'all people have like literally treated other people as dispensable, disposable, I'll get to them when I'm ready, yada, 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 yada. I gotta stop listening to Renaissance. It flows over into why these trips go so bad, right? It flows over into how y'all deal with people on the daily, whether you consider yourself a quote unquote bad friend or not. I've noticed no one considers themselves a bad friend. Nobody does. Nobody does. Although there'd be some people in the comments like, well, I don't care because my men come first, my partnership, my relationship come first. Like, y'all be too needy. Okay, baby. Love that for you. But at least it's honest. Like, you know what I'm saying? At the very least. However, what this leads to is a list of my pet peeves being when you get on the trip and what be happening when you're on the trip, right? One of my biggest things is timing etiquette. This goes beyond just the trip, but especially on the trip. You knew that excursion was 7:00 in the morning. You know what time we have to get up so you can eat if you want to have food before we go on the excursion at 7 o'clock in the morning. Now, me, I'm not going on a 7 o'clock in the morning excursion. That's when I get ready, I don't be doing nothing. When I get ready, I'm gonna tell you I'm not going. I will stay in the room and I won't ruin your time. I'm not going. When you come back, I'll be happy for you. I'll ask you how it was, but I'm not going. Period. You knew we had to be at that club at 12 midnight, by midnight, inside the club, not on the line, if we was gonna get in for free. The plug had our link set up for midnight. By midnight, shoes over the line, already checked by security, pat down from the Ruta to the Tuta by midnight. Why are you looking at me at 11:50 asking me if they gonna let us come? No, they're not. No, they're not. And when I'm upset about it and we get on the line anyway, and it's now 12:30 and they ask us for $40, you upset. What? Who are you mad at? Cause can't be me. I'm a person. I'm the girl that's relatively on time. Relatively because I'm not always an on the dot person. Things be happening, but it's because like some of it is a learned behavior dealing with the folk. You know what I mean when I say the folk, because the folk have turned timeliness into a manufactured faux pas that I've learned just not to commit anymore. Especially early. Forget early. Oh, please. If you know, you know. Plus, nothing gets me more irritated than being on schedule and then just sitting around waiting because the next person don't care about time. It's like they get a kick out of you sitting there waiting for them. Your face beat starting to melt. And they're just now jumping into their drawers. Diabolical. I could feel that in that just nastiness in my skin. So a girl ship is obviously going to bring about many opportunity, right? For you to potentially be late for something. And for me, one of the things that takes a lot of time, it doesn't have to, but it can, depending on how you're trying to go, is beating my face and getting it snatched for some photo ops, right? And actually, I'm going to come back to that concept in my next one. But one thing about me, my makeup is going to be done. Whether I'm giving you full glam or a touch up, I'm putting makeup on to get me to the next moment, especially when I'm on vacation, because I need to feel like a star. I'm not paying all these dollars to look like how I look when I'm at home, sitting on my couch, not when I'm in these people country. No, I'm not. So when I plan to get ready, as a relatively on-time girl with the spreadsheet and the schedule and the systems down, I plan for timing that includes all the things that I need to do. The shower, the makeup. That don't include last-minute requests to do other people's hair and makeup that they insisted they didn't need to do. But go on then, India Ari. Don't come to me now and ask for the Alicia Keys special, because now we late. We late. And if you're paying attention, I also now just picked up a third job. Travel agent, concierge, and MUA. Now don't look at me funny when we're running behind schedule because I'm late coming back from my third job. And also, this is not something that was unavoidable. I hope you have my $40 when we get to the spot because I did not plan to pay it. This might be slightly niche and be reserved for the people with friends they either need to not travel with or simply fully get rid of. The people who act like you're doing the most on a trip and you haven't even acted your worst. Going back to the makeup example. Sometimes I'm convinced that the commentary about makeup is supposed to convince you not to wear any. Granted, I don't think I thought about it that way in the moments that it's come up for me, because the people that I know that have been my friend and are my friends know me, and that would have never been on the table. Like, if that was your way of throwing a hint, I didn't just miss it because I be missing social cues sometimes. It completely just flew past my face. Like that video I saw the other day of a real life road runner, legs non-existent. I didn't, anywho, this is not that conversation. You know who I am, and you know I'm gonna put that on. You also know like how strong of a personality I am. So if anybody would have thought that being like, oh, I'm not wearing makeup on vacation was gonna make me not wear makeup, that was silly. I don't know, that was silly. Like, if you know me, that was silly, because I'm putting it on. I don't know what you thought. But I do know other people for whom like that was true for. Like, people made these comments and they were trying to get them to not do something so that they can make sure that they didn't look better than them on a trip. Good luck. That, again, that's probably not somebody you should be friends with at all. Just throwing it out there. And that's the thing, like, people will tell these stories and be like, yeah, you know, I noticed that she would do stuff like that when we would go out at the club back home. And then you decided to go across the border with shorty? It's not funny, especially in situations where, if God forbid I get in trouble, like, my only hope would be the U.S. Embassy. So when people ask the question of why do people stop being friends on these trips, it's not, the answer takes so long to tell. Also, some people just go on trips because they need somebody to split a room with. That's a separate one, but I throw it in this one too. People be asking you to go on trips getting somebody to split a room with. That's why people be traveling with strangers. They'll be like, oh, they look nice, they friends. They don't be friends. They just met somebody and traveled with them, which is completely like fine, right? Like, as a Sagittarius, I love a good stranger. I do. I love a good stranger. Not necessarily in the context of travel per se, because my room is gonna be separate. Like, we're not sharing a room. We're not doing that. However, the weak ties don't withstand things going wrong on a trip, when money is exchanging hands, and you know, when the dude come back and he decided he didn't like you as much as he liked your friend, and all those things, like, the stakes get real high for people, especially in the Instagram age, and you trying to poke. Oh, I'm gonna talk about that one separately. I'm gonna come back to it. Taking pictures on the group trip. Let me tell you something. Never going nowhere without an iPod. I mean, a tripod. Anyway, I'm gonna come back to that. Even this idea that people have friends who like joke on them all the time, or like kind of like, what's it called? It's not backhanded compliments, but just like have like the commentary about somebody being extra, for example, right? Like, those slick remarks that you get away with back home, maybe you should keep them tucked all the way away when you don't even know where the nearest U.S. embassy is, because you never know what you're going to need and how you're going to need the people you travel with. Like, the people who, you know, go travel and, you know, things unfortunately take a turn, they end up in a hospital in whatever country, and that country is like, yeah, so we need cash for that arm we just put back together. Now it's a GoFundMe, when it could have been travel insurance. It could have been a credit card with the balance on it, with the limit on it to get reimbursed by travel insurance. Now, that's a way higher stakes situation, but you never know. That's the point. You never know. And people think it can never be done until you end up in that situation. Leave that extra person alone, because you never know. The rise you get out of irritating and poking fun at the people who you call friends, and then your inability to turn it off, is something that you need to investigate. And possibly, you shouldn't go anywhere with them until you do. So let me go back to the taking pictures situation real quick. Prior to people getting comfortable using tripods and sticks outside, the selfie stick was like a cute wave, and then people stopped doing it because it was just like a fad or whatever. But like, this idea of having like the tripod outside made it was like, oh, influencer, right? Like, people are embarrassed to take their pictures, especially if they're alone or whatever. Get comfortable with it, girlfriend. Get comfortable. Again, why I'm a proponent of a good solo trip. I always get the pictures that I need when I travel solo. Let's just say. Unless I'm just like terrified to like do it and where I'm doing it, but you be going on a trip with the girls and the girls don't want to take a good picture of you. And it's something that sounds super shallow, like by itself, but when I really, you know, none of our experiences are ever just our experiences, right? I started realizing this when I would see other people say the same thing online, like under like a TikTok or something like that. And I started paying more attention to it, but it was something that I had noticed with someone that either they never sent me my pictures after they took them, or the pictures were always blurry, except for the one picture that was super terrible. Or, you know, I was getting down, getting angles, trying to be supportive. And I actually, people were like, oh, I hate taking pictures. What does that mean, bro? Stand there, snap the picture, go home. But at the same time, like, it's important for somebody to capture the experience where they want. And I know they want to post a picture on the gram. It's not that deep. I'm not an influencer by any stretch of the imagination. But I would try to, you know, get a good angle, get a good shot, whatever the case may be. Don't like it, don't enjoy it, but that's just what I'm doing to get a picture for somebody. It's not my whole life. It's like 5 minutes out of a trip, not even 5 minutes. At a certain particular spot that we're at per day, I'll be fine. And then I get some pictures, and I don't even take as many pictures in return. That's also the kicker, actually. And I would notice, like I would have to ask a lot for the pictures. Now, things be happening, you be forgetting, whatever. I would get pictures that I knew, like, something is missing from here. Cause I'll be like, oh, that particular pose, like, I wanna see how that looked so I could put it in this. And then you just notice it's not there. Then it's like, how did this many pictures come back blurry? Like, what's going on here? And the thing about it is that I would notice it not, it wasn't like one trip, it wasn't one outing, it was like over and over and over and over again. I remember, it's so crazy, I had actually believed, like, I just don't take good pictures. And for the most part, like, I'm not that comfortable in front of the camera. I'm still, you know, trying to see how I, you know, all that stuff, how I feel in front of the camera, what my angles are, all that. I'm just getting here, just getting here. But for a while, I honest to God truth, grown ass woman was like, damn, I just think that I, like, what I see in the mirror, like, maybe it's just distorted. And because the camera never captures me well, and I just kind of always come out a little ugly. Like, I swear to you, like, I started having, like, it's not body dysmorphia. Stop using. That's going to be another podcast episode. So I was just like, I don't know. Like, I stopped wanting to take pictures certain ways and whatever. It wasn't until I started traveling with somebody else that I was like, oh, this picture is, oh, I look good here. Like, other people started taking my picture, and all of a sudden I don't think I look ugly anymore. If we paid more attention to people's not verbal behavior and just the totality of our experience with people, we would make possibly different decisions. You're not supposed to feel uncomfortable when you're with somebody just because you said they were your friend. You can also not be someone's friend. It's an option. So, anywho, the pictures thing is a thing, especially pictures on vacation. You spent mad money going to this place. You might be a gram stunter. You might be a scrapbooker. You might be sending this to your mama. Like, whatever you've decided. Your man might be back at home, and you want to send him a good picture of you and your homegirls out. Your girl might be at home. Your whoever might be at home. Anybody that you want to see the picture, they want to see it. And now you've come back from a trip with no memories. Like, I'm a person that, like, pictures really help me jog a memory and really invoke, like, a feeling of, like, just, they just really trigger memories of what I was doing, like, in, like, motion picture, like a GIF. Like, I remember what I was experiencing, like in a GIF form. That's one of the ways that I like to use pictures. Now I don't got none because whatever your motivations were, I don't got no pictures. Anyway, that's my spiel on pictures. On a girl's trip. Speaking of men, and I don't want to make this such a head-focused thing, but, like, I'm speaking to a very specific type of person right now. And I'm speaking to heteronormative behavior more than likely. And I'm speaking to what I know. Okay? One thing I will never do is speak about things that I don't know. But the way some of y'all don't know how to act when we run into new men is a disgrace. Certain things will not apply to you listening to this if you're like a teenager, and if you are, kind of surprised you're here, but hello. Young 20s, very young 20s, like college age 20s, typical college age 20s, I should say. Things will keep happening with men in those years. It just is. But when we start to get a little older, when we are prioritizing safety, and we should always be prioritizing safety regardless of the ages men named, I don't understand how people just suddenly forget what people are capable of potentially just because we've changed zip codes, and now we are performing for the possibility of leaving the trip with a number or something. All of a sudden nobody can find you, and you're not returning anybody's text messages. I'm all for the girls having fun on vacation. After all, we outside, we looking all right. Attention is bound to be attracted. I get it. But you're gonna invite strangers into the room where we have all our valuables, and some people had to travel with their work devices because they on call for day one of the trip. And then you have the girls who don't feel like they had a good trip experience if we didn't get to interact with men. Just moping around, acting like they didn't get to do anything fun because they didn't get to giggle up under a man. You know the type. You know exactly. You thought of a person right now. Won't leave the club until a man locks eyes with them. You're half dead. It's 2:30 in the morning. But there she go. Waiting for that man in the corner to finally acknowledge her again. Listen, I'm going back to the room, doll. And I don't have a particular preference for type of stay for vacation, but this is one of the reasons why I'm an all-inclusive girly if it's going to be a girl trip, because I can just go back to the room and leave you and I'm not really going to think twice about your safety. If you get yanked off this all-inclusive resort, I don't know what to tell you. It shouldn't be that. It shouldn't be that. If you're abducted off this cruise, I'm not really sure. What was I going to do to stop it? But in other situations where we're like in society regularly, I'm not a fan. I don't know what it is. Well, I know what contributes to the problem. All I'm going to say is I'm just not here for it. I don't want anything to do with it. And as I've gotten older, it's not an age thing, it's just time thing for me. As time has passed in my life, like, I really do not care about seeing a man anywhere or anybody that I might be romantically interested in, or, well, you know, otherwise. Like, I didn't come on this trip and pay this monies to play Russian roulette with whether or not somebody gonna like me. The other day I was traveling and my gate was next to a gate that was going to Punta Cana. And when I saw, it's so funny. I was texting my homegirl. I seen this gathering of men, mostly black men, but okay. Gathering of men. And I was like, well, what kind of black male convention are these brothers going to today? Literally, that was my thought. So I'm like, I'm curious, and I go look, because I know I'm just going, you know, a couple steaks down the road. I'm like, well, what's going on? What am I missing? Punta Cana. If you are building your trip around running into men, and all the men is going on that trip to see people who are unlike you, if you catch my drift, you are going to leave heartbroken, dear. Self-esteem shot. Nothing good can come out of this. Let it go. Enjoy your homegirls, whoever you went on a trip with, or don't go. Trips can't just be an excuse. Yeah, you have, first of all, that's supposed to be set up ahead of time. That's a story for another day. People willing to put you in dangerous situations, put themselves in dangerous situations, and also not even just danger. It don't even just be about danger, because sometimes, you know, you know how to navigate, you know, whatever. It just be like, oh, we all sitting here, we all had plans to go to XYZ for dinner at 9 o'clock, and then suddenly you're missing still at 8:55 because nobody could find you for the last 20 minutes, and you're like, well, you're with Daryl, and y'all are gonna go eat somewhere else instead. Did we come here together or not? Like, we chose 9 o'clock because that's when you wanted to go eat. You know what I mean? Them type of things. I don't. So, defund the girls' trip. There are no funds for the girls' trip. The money is funny. Now, this one is layered, like truly layered. There's just so many reasons why you should not dig into money that people did not authorize you to have ahead of time and that they have not consented to. That's what I'm saying. So my first and favorite one, this is my go-to. The Uber apps never work when it's time to be somewhere outside of your home zip code. The fare split function is dead, defunct. One girl will always be real quiet about requesting the Ubers, and that'll be the person whose fare split also never works. But she'll never offer to request the Ubers. Neither will she remember to ask how much the Ubers are, so she can Zelle, Cash App, nothing. She won't offer to pay for drinks to cover the Uber she's been joyriding in. She ain't keeping track of a thing. She's not even acknowledging that she's missing the Uber rides that everybody is splitting. And this includes the damn $75 airport Uber. Specifically when it comes to things like Uber, and this is more of a domestic thing because there's rarely other places that I've used Uber outside of the continental United States, with the exception of Panama. Worked very well for me in Panama, but I was by myself. That for me is crazy sinister, because you know you got from point A to point B and you didn't put no money in it on it. And we are taking multiple Ubers over the course of a trip. It's not one off. It's not two off. It's like we're here for a week and you haven't paid for any of your rides. And you know you haven't. Make that make sense. I remember seeing, I've seen countless posts in Facebook travel groups of people trying to get someone to join them on a trip they either prepaid for or put money down on, and it's non-refundable and their friend backed out and they assumed all the risk. This is kind of travel 101 in general. I never, ever, ever book anything non-refundable or that can't be backed out of, period. If something requires a deposit, that deposit should be split with everyone agreeing to go on the trip. And if they can't put the money down to secure the booking, you don't have a trip to go on. Assume no responsibility for anything. I would seriously, truly end friendships over this. Back to the whole thing about comment about paying my light bill. Yeah. I've never had this happen to me personally, because this is not a risk I've ever been willing to take. I don't book non-refundable things. Anyone who is comfortable sticking you with financial risk for the imaginative thought that they could be able to go on a trip is not your friend. Please understand that. Traveling broke. I don't have to go over something that's been talked about at length in many people's situations and stories. I've never had someone who like intentionally traveled broke with me or on a, you know, a group trip that I was on to the point where it was like we had to spot them and it was like a surprise. No, I've never had that happen to me. I know it happens to people, and it's, I have had the person who opts to travel or go somewhere with you and they're broke, and so they remind you or not remind, well, they remind you by not, by indirectly making commentary on how much everything costs and what they're willing to spend, and like what they're willing to spend, and making it seem like everything is just priced ridiculously, and oh, that's too expensive, and oh, we gotta do this, and oh, I'm not talking about free before 12 at the club, because that's just smart money management. If you can get your behind out the door 30 minutes faster, this same experience can cost $0. I'm there. Okay? Because I budget. That's another thing. I have budgets for trips. I'll get there. That'll be in my next point about money. Funny money. But me going on a trip with someone, if you go on a trip with somebody, like, I'm not saying, again, because I budget, don't have an unlimited, I'm not requiring you to have a bottomless pit of money. However, if you want to go to Miami with $100 for a week, stay in your house and watch Baggers Club instead. Period. There's nothing else to add. To my commentary before about people who want to go on trips just to split a room, they don't really be your friends. I had an experience some years ago. I don't remember if I talked about it on this podcast before, but long story short, I was broke. And I did my math beforehand and I was like, listen, I cannot afford to go on this trip. I'm not going to go. The person convinced me to go under the guise of helping me out. And they were driving for a good leg of the trip. And how that would help offset costs, because I couldn't afford a plane ticket. That's number one. If I can afford a plane ticket to get there, much more. Long story short, because I won't even tell the whole thing, they were banking on me coming so that they could potentially, so that they could squat in a hotel room that I didn't, that I thought we were going to be sharing. Like, I thought we were splitting the cost of a hotel room. I think the reason why I said I can't afford to go is when I realized that when I sent a hotel, they were like, oh, is that your room? And I was like, oh, you're not staying with me. Anyway, I let them convince me that it was going to be all good. And basically, not only did that, was that like just not even true, they also were counting on me to fill up their gas tank for the round trip, which was, the round trip for them was not even all the way to my destination. And of course, they also only used ultra gas in like a 93 car. So don't even get me started. And they also had other people driving down in the vehicle that were paying them to drive, like putting money on the gas to drive them there. Don't let people catch you in foolishness for the sake of travel, okay? So on the flip side of don't come when you're broke, I'm not cheap when I travel, but people who don't know how to travel economically, I don't want to go. Some trips are not worth the price. But I just don't go sign on to a trip because it would be nice to go on a fun trip with you. Like, we can go to brunch. And then I'm like, oh, I went out of town with somebody that I liked and I have a picture. Like, it's, I'm supposed to experience things while I'm out here, right? Everybody's not gonna be like a, I don't consider myself like a top-notch traveler. Like, I know all the things. But I know a little something about a little something. And you picking this package deal from hotels.com. And I'm like, hotels.com got the hotel for more than the actual hotel. And God forbid, you ever been stranded in a bad hotel and Expedia is looking at you like, I don't know what you're talking about, but have a good night. And you stuck? Or you're in the airport. They love this in the airport. You're in the airport. Some cancellations happen, whatever. You need to rebook. And they're looking at you like, oh, girl, you got to call Expedia. And you're like, huh? That's one of the reasons why I book. Another reason why I book directly. I can't travel with other people who don't take similar things into account. It's okay that you don't, but you can't, don't do that with me. Those are my financial woes about being on group trips. Don't even get me started. There was a whole world. It almost caught me too. That whole trend of the wellness retreats, the women's wellness retreats and all that. And half them heifers was scammers. You had to wire them money instead of whatever other, because they didn't want to pay taxes, I guess. Or whatever else they was doing with the money. Then you showed up and you were sleeping on cots instead of the luxury. Everything says slap luxury on it. Accommodations. I almost got. And that's why you can't convince me into certain group antics sometimes. Like, it just, funny money. So, back to a point that I was making at the beginning, right? At the core of this is really a larger conversation about community that is kind of sort of happening, but a lot of people are not taking seriously. Many of us don't know how to exist with others, either without steamrolling them or without shrinking ourselves to fit in with a dynamic peacefully. And honestly, this was me too. In many familial contexts, people just kind of fit themselves into roles and just stay there. But that won't work for friends. And it definitely won't work when you find yourself in a hotel room with 4 to 6 girls out of 4 to 6 girls out of town, sharing one, maybe two bathrooms if you're lucky, and immersed in a culture that's not your own and depending only on each other for survival and camaraderie, funded by your own dollars. And I think until we get real about the way that we treat other people and really think about how we treat platonic relationships as a convenience and as something that you pick back up when you're ready, or as something that's supposed to fulfill all your needs without the consent, the enthusiastic consent of all the people that you are in community with, we're going to continue to run into these problems. And then we further complicate them or the dynamic by bringing this into a travel situation. Like, the trip brought us closer together type stuff. Putting any relationship under additional stress and like new circumstances does not bring it together. If the tools were not there, somebody is either having a very bad time in order to make the whole thing go peacefully, or somebody is like forcing, steamrolling, controlling to make sure that the whole thing stays together, or just the whole thing is happening underneath the guise of, we're all right, we fine. Mm-hmm. Stop taking fragile situations out on a trip. Until you fix it, leave it in your home zip code. So for me, I have withdrawn my funds from participation in group activities that will leave a mark on something that I enjoy doing very much when I am by myself, that is intended to rejuvenate and be just fun. No thanks. Thank you for listening to another episode of the Disrupting Silence podcast. In the show notes, you'll find a link to join the weekly insider newsletter community for like-minded disruptors, people pondering their purpose, and recovering perfectionists. You can also follow me on Instagram and Threads at PatPontificates. Links are also in the show notes. If you have a listener question or just want to connect with me directly about something, send me an email at hello@patpontificates.com. Until next time.